coming back. We are in a message series now called A Value-Driven Life, Living a Life of Purpose. And last week, Pastor Brian kicked us off with value number one, reaching people. That's our number one value as a church because people matter to God, so they should matter to us. He talked about Matthew 9:37, where Jesus said that the harvest is great, but the workers are few, and that we are called to be workers in that harvest. Reaching people is where it all begins. Today, we're going to jump into value number two, growing people. And see, when we reach people, we can't just stop there. There is a process after that as well. Jesus, before he left earth, he gave us the Great Commission that says, go into all the world and make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey all that I've commanded. And he said he would be with us to the end of the age. Now, that Great Commission to go into all the world is actually as you're going about your life, as you're going about your day-to-day things, we are called to make disciples. And to make a disciple means to introduce them to Christ, to get them into a relationship with God. We plant and water seeds. We are laborers in the harvest, like Pastor Brian talked about last week. But then he says to baptize them and teach them. See, oftentimes we look at salvation as a destination. We want to pray that prayer with people. We want them to trust Christ, and then we want to leave them to their own devices. That's not how this works. That's not how this works at all. Discipleship is a lifelong thing. It is a mentoring process. See, I heard someone describe it this way. He used the analogy of a baby. And he said, you know, when you are born, you need someone to feed you. You need someone to clothe you, someone to take care of you. But the goal is that you learn to feed yourself and that you eventually become an adult where you can feed yourself and feed other people. Scripture talks about this as well. The writer of the book of Hebrews, and you can turn there with me, Hebrews chapter 5, in verse 12. The writer of the book of Hebrews gives us a discussion that goes right along with this analogy. He talks to us about what it means to go from being a baby to being a spiritual adult. And that's what growing people is really all about. We're talking about coming to spiritual maturity. See, when you are a disciple, you enter in and you are a spiritual infant, and you need someone who can be there to guide you, to lead you to spiritual adulthood. But if you're in Hebrews chapter 5 now, you'll see in verse 12, the writer says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have had their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. So as we're talking about growing people, what we're really talking about is guiding people to spiritual maturity. And I know that that phrase in and of itself can sometimes seem a little bit ambiguous. Like, what is maturity? What does that look like? What does it mean to be spiritually mature? Well, the writer of Hebrews says that you have your powers of discernment tested by practice, knowing what's good from evil. See, there's this aspect that as you mature spiritually, you begin to be able to discern the world. You begin to be able to see it through God's eyes, and that you can interact the world the way that he does. You know, if we go back to that analogy of the baby growing to a mature adult, if you are a baby, no one expects you to care for yourself. You know, my son just turned 18 years old a couple days ago. And as we've watched him grow, you know, as an 18-year-old, there are expectations that I have of him. He has a job. He drives a car. There are some things I expect him to be responsible with that I wouldn't expect from an infant. You know, there's a family in our church, the Blooms, and they have a little baby boy. He's just a few months old. And if their little baby boy woke up in the middle of the night and walked downstairs and fed himself, they'd be pretty shocked, right? You wouldn't expect that from a three-month-old. But if my 18-year-old laid in his bed at night and cried and cried and cried until mom and I came upstairs and put a bottle in his mouth, that would be a problem, right? Well, that's what happens with us spiritually sometimes. See, there's an expectation when you come to Christ that you are this spiritual infant, and it's okay for you to need help. It's okay for you to need someone to run to you and feed you and help you do through things. But if you've been a believer for 20 years and you're still laying in your bed at night crying for someone to come feed you, that's a little bit of a problem. And that's what we're going to talk through today in this idea of growing people. I'm going to give you three things today that you need to understand about spiritual growth, about spiritual maturity, that will help you assess where you are and hopefully help us see how we can begin to grow in Christ and we can help others grow along that path as well. And we're going to be using several different verses. I'm going to jump around. All the scriptures are going to be on your screen because typically as I teach, I like to just find one passage and kind of break that down. But this idea of spiritual maturity is woven all throughout the New Testament. So we're going to look at a few different places, and we're going to move kind of fast, so I need you to keep up with me. But we're going to get three things that help us understand spiritual maturity. And the first thing is this. It's about God's work in you, not your work for him. It's about God's work in you, not your work for him. See, oftentimes we look at people who do things for God and we assume that they are spiritually mature. See, they have a gifting or a calling. Maybe they have a special talent that we don't have, and we assume that because of that, they are more mature than we are. But no, scripture says it's about God's work in us. If you look in Philippians chapter 1, let's turn there real quick. If you go to Philippians chapter 1, it's just a few books back from where we are. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. So it's right in the middle of the letters from Paul. In Philippians 1:6, it says, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it," or will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. See, what that means is that God initiates this work in you, and it's him who will bring it to completion. It's not about your work for him. It's about his work in you. The Apostle Paul, who wrote the book of Philippians, goes on to say, if you just look over one page into Philippians chapter 2, he goes on to say in verse 12, he says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Now, I know this thing of work out your own salvation sounds a little weird. It almost sounds like we're being told to do works-based salvation. That's not what the writer's saying here. When he talks about work out, what he's really talking about is submitting to the process. He wants you to submit to the process of salvation. And that work out your own salvation thing is really saying submit to the process of being conformed to the image of Christ. And the reason he talks about fear and trembling being involved there is because there's a lot of work to do. We have to realize that we are unholy people in front of a holy God, and we have a holy God dwelling in us, the blood of Jesus cleansing us, making us holy, but the holy God dwelling in us, purifying us from the inside out. He's making us right, leading us into right standing as we are being conformed to the image of the Son. See, it's not about your work for God. It's about his work in you. And he wants us to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. He wants us to submit to the process. He wants us to willingly give ourselves over to this process, to realize that there's a lot of work to do. If you think about a sculptor who walks up to this giant rock, and you and I would look at it and say, hey, that's just a big hunk of rock, get it out of the way. No, this sculptor sees something beautiful on the inside. And that is the completed work that the sculptor is trying to get to. And today you may look like this big hunk of rock, and he's got a lot to chisel away. He's got a lot to knock away. But he sees what's inside you. He sees what he's going to bring to completion in you if you willingly submit to that process. And that's how we can step into this, is understanding that this is a process. Spiritual growth is different for everyone. And this actually takes us to thing number two that you need to understand about spiritual maturity. And that's this: you'll know by your fruit. You're going to know by your fruit. See, spiritual maturity works different in each of us. There are times in our lives that we grow and we grow and we grow. And then there are other times where it feels like we haven't grown much at all. And you may have someone that you know that you're like, I know this person's a Christian, but man, it seems like they are taking forever to get over some things that I got over with pretty quickly. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7 that we're going to know people by their fruit. He was talking about false teachers who come in and they bear false witness. And Jesus said a good tree can only produce good fruit, or a healthy tree can only produce healthy fruit, but a bad tree is going to produce bad fruit. You're going to know them by their fruit. And the same is true with you. You can know by your fruit. You can see how you are maturing by your fruit. Now, there are times in life where we struggle with things and we come to know Christ, and he makes the decision to take those things away from us instantaneously. I think about my grandmother, who's no longer with us. She's gone to be with the Lord a few years ago. But my grandmother, when I was growing up, she had a little bit of a drinking problem. And I say a little bit, it was actually a lot a bit of a drinking problem. But she came to know Christ, and this was in the early 1990s. And I remember so vividly as she walked down to the altar and as the pastor prayed for her. From that day forward, my grandmother never had desire for another drop of alcohol. God took that away from her instantaneously. And I have some things that I'm like, you know, God, I struggle with these things right here. I wish you would take them from me instantly, but he's chosen to leave those things. I don't understand why or how he sorts all of that out, but he does it in his sovereignty. And there may be some things that you struggle with, some things that you're like, man, I've been wrestling with this my whole life, and it just feels like I cannot get a grip on it. Here's what I want you to understand. Spiritual maturity is about who has influence in your life. You know, when we are saved, when we are born again, it's that the Bible says that the Holy Spirit comes to dwell in us, and the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead now quickens us or makes alive our mortal bodies. And what happens as we mature in Christ is that the Holy Spirit becomes the dominant influence in our lives and our flesh begins to dwindle. And so what we run into sometimes is this battle between our flesh saying, I want what I want, I want what I desire, and the Spirit of God in us saying, I need you to follow my way. I need you to willingly submit to this process of working out your own salvation. And as we mature, the Holy Spirit's voice gets louder and louder and our flesh gets quieter and quieter. And the reason sometimes we seem stuck is because we don't willingly submit to that process. And so what happens is our voice, our flesh, our desires remain so loud in our life that we can't clearly hear the voice of God or see where he's leading us. And so as we mature, as we have our powers of discernment tested and by practice and knowing what's right and wrong, knowing good from evil, the Holy Spirit's voice becomes so much louder. We hear him so much clearer and we're able to follow the path that he has for our lives. And you may be wondering, like, what is this fruit that I'm talking about? What is your life fruit that you can look at and say, I know I am maturing? If you look at Galatians chapter 5, and we can go there now. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22, scripture says the fruit of the Spirit. We're in the book of Philippians. If you just turn backwards a couple of pages, a few pages, you'll run right into Galatians chapter 5. Verse 22, it says the fruit of the Spirit is this: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Think about all of those things. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. They are all contrary to our human nature. And see, that's that battle, that internal battle of the flesh warring against the Spirit of God, fighting for control, fighting for influence in our lives. As the Holy Spirit grows you, matures you, as you willingly submit to that process in him, his fruit become more and more evident in your life. You have more patience. You have more joy. You are able to walk in love and compassion. You have gentleness and goodness and self-control. Those things become evident in your life, and you're able to look at those fruits, and other people can see that fruit as well. If you remember Pastor Brian's message from last week, he talked about how people are watching us, that as we're trying to reach people, they're watching us. They're watching, how do you respond to your spouse? How do you respond to your kids when you're angry? How do you respond to your coworkers? Are you constantly anxious? And if you have the fruit of the Spirit in your life, if you are growing and maturing in Christ, you'll have this fruit so that when someone upsets you, you'll have patience. And people will see that and they'll know that you're a child of God. You'll have this fruit in your life so that when troubling things come and you want to feel anxious, you'll have joy unspeakable and full of glory. And people will see that and they will know that you are a child of God. You'll walk with love. You'll walk with compassion. People will see you in the midst of turmoil when everyone else seems to be dealing in hate. You'll be dealing in love, and people will see that and they will know that you are a child of God. And because of that fruit, they will want what you have. And then they will come to you and say, help me get there. Be my guide. Show me how I can have what you have in your life. But it only comes by maturing in Christ. So see, and again, just understand that maturing in him, it's about God's work in you, not your work for him. And you're going to know by your fruit whether or not you are maturing in him. But again, even that fruit is God initiated. It's the Holy Spirit's work in you. It's the Holy Spirit becoming the main dominant influence in your life. And the third thing that I need you to understand about spiritual maturity is this: you can't do it alone. This is not a process that we go on by ourselves. See, there is a story in scripture of this man named Paul, and Paul knew a young man named Timothy. By all accounts, Paul and Timothy met around 50 AD. And there are two books in the Bible written by Paul to Timothy, 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, and they were both written between 62 and 64 AD. So by the time Paul wrote these books, him and Timothy had approximately a 12 to 14 year relationship. And that's a first key there in understanding true discipleship and understanding growing people, is that it's a process and that it takes time. Even when Jesus walked with his disciples, you know, Jesus had a 3.5 year ministry while he was here on earth. And in our mind, we think about the miracles. It almost seems like Jesus spent all his time preaching to people and performing miracles. But Jesus actually spent most of his time with 12 men, teaching them almost in a one-on-one fashion, developing relationships with them That's what true discipleship is. It's walking with people. It's not just leading them or guiding them to Christ. It's guiding them to life in Christ. This understanding that this is a life thing. It's not a one-time thing. This is a life deal. And that the goal is that they spend their entire lifespan, whatever they have left from the time they meet Christ until the time they go to be with him, that that time is spent maturing in him. But here's what I really came to understand about spiritual maturity. I can't mature myself. You know, if we go back to this idea of the baby, if you have a baby and you just say, we get home, you take the baby to the house next door, you put him in the house, you say, hey, kid, you're home, you're born now, you're home, this is your house, have at it. How long do you think that baby's going to make it? But that's what we do to new believers oftentimes. We say, hey, you prayed that prayer. I'm so excited for you. We've been working for months to get to this point. Now you're here. Here's a Bible. Have at it. Go have fun. And then we wonder why months later they are struggling, they're falling into sin. See, they have no spiritual parent there. They have no one there who's going to guide them. And I think it's cool that Paul actually referred to Timothy as his child in Christ. And I think if we took on that mindset when we help people grow, that these are our children in Christ, we will understand the responsibility that we have to walk alongside that person, not just until they come to know Christ, but from that point forward. And you may think, man, this is a daunting task, but the Lord challenged me a few years ago. He challenged me to think small, to think small to grow, to think small to grow. And what I mean by that is this. He said, stop trying to disciple 1,000 people at once. Find 5 people that you can pour into and disciple those people. And if those 5 go out and find 5 more, that's how Jesus did discipleship. He took 12 men that he poured into, and then 11 of them went out and they found more men that they poured into, and then they changed the world. Amen. And we can do that too, church, if we are willing to take the time to invest in people, if we're willing to take the time to walk alongside them as they grow in Christ. And so my thing with this is, or the thing that I want you to get out of this is that all of us should have a Paul and all of us should have a Timothy. All of us should have someone who's leading us and guiding us, someone who's kind of blazed that trail for us. And we should all have a Timothy, someone that we are leading and that we are guiding. Do you know who those people are in your life? Do you know who they are? And some of you may be staring back into this camera right now as a church and saying, yeah, I know my Pauls, Jay. That's you and Pastor Brian. Let me tell you this, church, and this may hurt some of your feelings a little bit. Pastor Brian and I cannot be Paul to everyone. Not to everyone in a church this size, not to everyone in a church of 50 people or 5,000 people. It's just not possible. That's actually not the way God intended it. See, the way church works, if you read through Ephesians chapter 4, our job is to equip you and edify you for the work of ministry. This idea of discipleship, though, is relational. Discipleship, true maturity in Christ, true understanding of who the Holy Spirit is and how he works in your life, a true modeling of how you live this Christian life, is relational. And when I say that, what I'm really saying to you is this. There may be 5 or 10 of you that Pastor Brian and I can pour into directly, that we can really invest in, that we can walk this path of real true discipleship mentoring with for years and years to come. And then those 5 or 10 can do the same with 5 or 10 more, and then they can do the same with 5 or 10 more. This is why we really stress the importance of city groups. This is where you are going to find that relational mentoring that you so desperately need in life. And if you are one of the people that Pastor Brian and I are in relationship with in a discipleship fashion, then understand how that relationship works as well, that we are there trying to guide you to life in Christ or guide you to spiritual maturity, but we can't take you somewhere we've never been. So it's important for us, even as pastors, to have men who are over us, who are guiding us and leading us, taking us to a place where we've never been. And church, hear me when I say this. I really feel like this is part of what's going wrong with the church in America today, is that we've lost this idea of being led. None of us wants to be led. We all want to figure it out on our own. None of us wants to submit to spiritual authority. We all want to try to do this ourselves. So we go and we buy 50,000 discipleship books. We watch 40 or we listen to 48 podcasts. We have 50 different pastors that we listen to. And I'm not saying that any of that is wrong. I listen to podcasts all the time. I love reading books. I've got a whole library upstairs in my house. I'm not saying that that's wrong at all. What I'm saying to you is that you will only get so far that way in life. You need to have true discipleship relationships, true mentoring relationships, where there is someone who can act as Paul in your life, who can guide you, mature you, help you follow the path that the Lord has laid out for you, and that can take you to a place they've already been because they've blazed that trail. See, this isn't a comparison thing. And I think that that's what holds us back sometimes is we look at another person and we think to ourselves, man, they're so much further along than I am. I could never get to where they are. It's not about comparison, because understand this, comparison breeds confusion in our lives. Comparison breeds confusion, because what happens is when we start to compare, we start to feel like we don't measure up and we don't understand why. And then that confusion breeds complacency. And then you become complacent. You're like, man, I don't read scripture the way that they do. I can't understand it. I listen to them pray. I just can't pray the way that they do. So I'm just not even going to try. And most of us go through our lives as spiritual infants. We don't mature in Christ. We don't grow in him. We cease to mature because we cease to willingly submit to that process. And you may find yourself in a place today where you're like, Pastor Jay, I hear you. I hear everything that you're saying, but I really just don't know how to step into this process. So here's what I would encourage you to do. Let's figure out who's the Paul in your life, and let's figure out who's the Timothy in your life. And here's where I really felt like God challenged me in this. And this is just your pastor being transparent for a moment. I stepped into this role as a senior pastor here at Seven Cities Church. And my desire was never to build a church. That's God's work. That's God's responsibility to build a church. Scripture says that God is the one who adds to the church each and every day. My responsibility is to build people. My responsibility is to build up those that God sends through the doors of the church, to make sure that when you step into our church, that we are a place that we can truly guide you to life in Christ. But in order to be that guide, I have to be taking you somewhere that I have already been. And here's where God really challenged me. The question that he asked me was, am I maturing? Am I maturing in him? Or am I still a spiritual infant? And sometimes, again, because we tend to associate position and titles with spiritual maturity, sometimes we look at a person who has the title of pastor or deacon, or maybe they lead music, or maybe they're leading your small group or something, and we automatically assume that they are spiritually mature, and they may not be. Now, I'm not saying to you that I'm a spiritual infant. Please don't take this that way. Don't be like, oh my gosh, we done come to a church and this guy, he doesn't even know how to mature. That's not what I'm saying to you at all. But what I'm saying to you is that the Lord really challenged me to assess, how am I maturing? How am I growing in him? Do I have a Paul or multiple people who can function in that role of Paul in my life? And are there people in my life that I am a Paul to? And if I am a Paul to them, am I really qualified to be in that position? Where am I leading them? Where am I guiding them? See, when we talk about this idea of maturing people, understand this. Mature believers create space for other people to grow. That's our role. Mature believers create space for other people to grow. And that's why this comes back to, it's not a comparison thing. Sometimes when we get caught up in comparison, we don't want to create space for others to grow because we're afraid they're going to surpass us. No, our desire should be for them to surpass us. Our desire should be for them to walk and have a relationship with God where they are able to mature in him. And then we can look at them and say, wow, look what God has done in their life. And I'm so thankful that I got to be a small part of that. Do you have those relationships in your life? Are there people in your life that you can look at and say, hey, I am helping this person mature in Christ? And are you at a place where you are maturing in Christ? See, understand this, church. As we walk this path of growing people, remember, it starts with reaching them. You can't grow what's dead. So we have to reach them with Christ. They have to come to know him. They have to enter into a relationship with him. But then once they do, are we doing our part to fulfill the Great Commission, not just making disciples, but building lifelong discipleship-based relationships? Are we doing that in our lives? Are we being Paul for someone else? Or are we spending all of our time just focused on us, trying to get through life on our own? So think about those three things. Think about this aspect of, it's not about my work for God, it's about his work in me. Think about this aspect of fruit. What is the fruit of God in your life? What is the fruit that you can look at and say, I know I am maturing in him because I see this fruit coming up each and every day. Every time I'm in a situation, I feel myself becoming more patient. I feel myself becoming more loving. I feel myself being more gentle and more good and having more self-control. And ask yourself the question, am I trying to do this alone? Or is there a person in my life that I could say, that's my Paul, that's my Timothy. I have these discipleship relationships that I'm functioning in, and I am maturing in Christ, and I am helping others mature Mature believers create space for other people to grow. Are you helping someone grow? I hope that as a church, that we stick to our mission, that we stick to this idea that we are guiding people to life in Christ. And these first two values that we have laid out for you, reaching people and growing people, they really fulfill that mission statement that we're going to guide them to life in Christ. We have to reach them first, and then we have to help them grow, not just in a class, not just in a 1 or 2 week thing, but this is a process. This is a journey that we are on with them as they move towards life in Christ. Are you ready to step into that? I know that I am. Church, can I pray for you? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for this opportunity, Lord. I pray that you would help us as we reach the community around us, as we help people, or as we reach people, as Pastor Brian talked about last week, as we reach people, Lord, I pray that you would help us to not just want to reach them, Father, but that we would have a heart that desires to help them grow. That we would look at the world around us as you did, Jesus, and be moved with compassion because the world is in need of a Savior. They are sheep without a shepherd, Lord, and we know that you are the Savior. Help us to see the world around us in such a way that we are willing to not just reach them for you, Father, but to help them grow. And then as we grow in you, as we mature in you, Lord, help us to have eyes that see people the way that you do. Help us to enter into these relationships in such a way, Father, that we are willing to take the long road, Lord, that we are willing to put in the time, put in the investment that is needed to help a person mature in Christ, realizing that that's the model that you laid, Lord Jesus. That's the model that your disciples laid, and that's the model that we should follow, that we invest individually, that this is a relational thing, that it isn't all about Sunday morning, but church is what happens 7 days a week. It's not just one day, it's 7 days a week. Help us to be the church that understands that. Help us to be the church that is faithful to that, faithful to not just reaching people, but helping people grow. And Lord, as we guide people to life in Christ, Father, we pray that your Spirit be ever present with us, that we be led by your Spirit, because it's only your Spirit that breaks the yoke of bondage. It's only your Spirit that breaks chains off of our life, Lord. It's only your Spirit that sets captives free. So, Father, we pray for freedom today, that people would be set free, Lord. We pray for people that don't know you, that they would come to know you, Lord. And we pray for those that do know you, that they would mature in you, Lord, that as we grow towards you, that as we grow in you, Lord, that your love, your life, your peace, your patience, your joy would be so evident in our lives that those around us would see it and want to know you because of it. We love you, Lord, and we praise you. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.